The sunlight shines down from above as we find ourselves near the center of Balboa Park at the Museum of Photographic Arts. It focuses on film photography and video media. There are different collections that change throughout the year. One of them is Magic and Myth, which showcases the art of young local artists in grades K through 12 from San Diego County and Tijuana. An art gallery is often experienced by gathering what our eyes see before us and working out a story in our heads. All artists appreciate observers who take time to process what is before them, before moving on to the next piece. It also helps to hear comments of others. Feel free to pause this video to listen to your own thoughts while watching. In viewing these creations of young artists, several themes emerge. The first points to change. Of all the creatures on our planet, butterflies seem to hold a special place when it comes to metamorphosis and change. Once the egg hatches into a caterpillar, it feeds to prepare for its chrysalis stage and emerge as a butterfly. These young artists are also in a time of change, as they gain their education and discover who they want to be. We are fortunate that this year's youth exhibition received nearly 700 entries, showing an interest in the arts that will continue into the future. In this work entitled Change, the artist wields a wand to change the world for the better and free children from bullying. Although the artist is only 10, she must draw from her experiences in life. Notice how there is a butterfly hidden by the tree next to her. Another collage shows a young girl with wings flying above a house while a penguin looks on. This art resembles the fabric of our dreams, which often combines different places, people, and things. The raccoon seems concerned for her safety. Sometimes we feel we are flying in our dreams. Perhaps some people dream of being a butterfly soaring high above the clouds. An ancient Chinese myth suggests while we are awake, we may all really be butterflies, dreaming we are human. Mirrors show us in real time who we are and let us imagine who we want to be in the future. It's no surprise that butterfly wings would be a welcome change in a magic and myth art piece. Butterflies always radiate a magical and ethereal quality when we are in their presence. For us, they symbolize transformation and change, hope for the future, and the joyous comfort of our natural world. Another theme that emerges in the Magic and Myth exhibit is self-confidence in relation to power and responsibility. These three goddesses of life are role models for the young artist who is beginning to find her own identity. By looking at our own reflection in water, we learn to appreciate the time we are granted to exist on this earth. No one is perfect or ever will be. It's best to accept who we are and help others to see they will be fine, no matter what ripples may disturb the water's surface. Many of us have been told to be ourselves. However, in certain situations, it helps to use our imaginations. This piece shows self-confidence can be gained by imagining a strong and fearless creature like a dragon living within. Young artists in their formative years realize they have power to make a difference in the world. What they do with that power is, as it was told to a spidery superhero, with great power comes great responsibility. This superhero's powerful strength is put to good use carrying mountains. You could ask, where was the mountain before, and where will it be put down? Why was it moved? Valid questions, and our imaginations are exercised to answer them for us. The Nike shoes are not really necessary when you can levitate in mid-air. What is this cloaked figure thinking while manipulating lightning above the land below? We hope the intentions are good, but who knows for sure? The title of this piece is A Foggy Memory. Ironically, it's very clear, with two figures resting under a mushroom grove next to a crystalline mountain. There is some fog obscuring the starry night sky. Whether this memory is foggy or not, honor and remembrance is another theme in magic and myth. The COVID-19 pandemic took away our dignity and freedom, and more to the point, our friends and relatives. This girl plants a single flower to remember those who have gone too soon. In this realistic image, we see the loose tethers of a spirit lifting the body of someone who has recently departed. Atop the wedding arch below is a tiny bird watching. Is it the soul that has left its body? Or perhaps it's another soul grieving? A simple photo captured on a cloudy winter morning by a girl walking behind her mother in downtown Chicago. They are walking to the wake of her lolo, or grandfather in Filipino, as the mother recalls stories of her childhood. Stories the grandfather never had the chance to tell, and now never will tell his granddaughter. The phoenix is an immortal bird, said to rise from its ashes as it burns in the flames it generates every 500 years. It stands for rebirth, hope, and renewal. Although we are not immortal, the phoenix encourages us to hold on to life and fight with all our human spirit. When someone has been taken from us, we still must live our lives. That's what they would have wanted, is what we say. But if you look far enough inward, they never really left us. Even though someone's physical body is gone, there are always objects, scents, sounds, or places that let us know they are still here with us and within us. The Magic 8-Ball children's toy gives us the answer to any question we ask of it. This piece displays yes, no, and maybe in reflected lights through a glass sphere. The theme here shows young artists are starting to understand the world and know the difference between good and bad and right and wrong. These photos are described as someone sacrificing another person's life in order to rise in prestige and power. The artist acknowledges violence is wrong and implies that taking advantage of others for one's own benefit is not only immoral, but robs them of human decency and respect. Before the internet and cell phones, we interacted more directly with our physical world. This artwork shows how the digital world is taking more and more of our attention, just as we are sharing this time online right now at the Museum of Photographic Arts. This photo expresses the reality we live in may not be as clear as we think. If we squint our eyes or move further away, the pixels form into a portrait of the artist's friend. Changing your perspective can help clarify solutions to problems. This stop-motion film called Ramon was created by a young artist showing the wrestling match between Ramon and El Diablo. It's a struggle between good and evil, and conveys the culture of Mexico through the bravery and magic of luchador wrestling. Lucha libre, as it's called, developed in the early 20th century and quickly gained favor with acrobatic maneuvers, fast-paced action, and colorful masks. If you search for the most famous luchador, one name appears more often than not, Rodolfo Guzmán Huerta, better known as El Santo, or the Saint. The silver mask El Santo wore earned him the nickname El Enmascarado de Plata, or the Man in the Silver Mask. His wrestling career spanned nearly 5 decades, from 1934 to 1982. And in 1942, he took on the wrestling identity of El Santo. Even though he was a lucha libre rudo, or bad guy, he defended Mexico's honor by defeating a foreigner for the NWA Welterweight Championship in 1946. From then, many fans thought of him as a protector of Mexico. In the 1950s, El Santo had comic books written about him and had up to 4 different series published at the same time. El Santo was asked to star in movies, and over the course of 24 years, he appeared in 52 films in total. All the while, he continued wrestling and switched from a rudo into a técnico, or good guy, which only helped to increase the admiration of his fans. El Santo never removed his mask in public to maintain the persona and mystery that attracts everyone's curiosity. He did, however, remove it once. Appearing on a talk show, El Santo lifted his mask without warning with his eyes closed, as if to say goodbye to his fans. He must have known something was wrong. 10 days later, El Santo suffered a fatal heart attack. Rodolfo Guzmán Huerta was laid to rest in Mexico City, and at his request, wearing the mask of El Santo. A statue and a museum was built in his honor in his birthplace of Tulancingo. In the hearts and memories of the Mexican people, El Santo had become not just a luchador, but a folk hero and legend. The mask one wears to cover a face or an encounter with something new empowers our next theme to rise to the surface. Like this cat with a butterfly, young artists have a strong sense of curiosity about our world. In previous generations, we had to learn subjects through books, as this squirrel is studying about magic. Now, almost any subject can be learned through the internet. Information is literally at our fingertips to satisfy our curiosities. The knowledge we gain seems to give us a third eye when looking at the world. We can put our eyes virtually anywhere on the planet and see what is happening on the other side. If there is an unexplored path, you can be certain our curiosity will draw us in to see where it leads. What is around the corner? And is it a better place than where we are? There's only one way to find out. If a trail in the woods appears to be magical, it's a good idea to evaluate the origins of that magic. Despite whether or not this being is completely safe, our sense of intrigue still draws us toward it. Above us are birds flying in formation. Our minds try to rationalize the situation. The flying boat seems appropriate above the water, but have you also thought, how would actual living birds' wings be attached to an inanimate boat? Sometimes it's better to forego our curiosity and just appreciate the mythical boat as it slowly beats its wings away from the setting sun. This figure has a head filled with air, caused by obsessive daydreaming. These dreams may be the reason for another theme in the Magic and Myth collection, the presence of animal familiars. Magical beings like witches and warlocks often have a familiar or a small spirit assistant in the form of an animal. These young artists have merged their human form together with an animal form. Where a vampire transforms into a bat, a witch shapeshifts into a cat. These alter egos, or separate animal familiars, extend their reach of influence. Some choose a flying creature, like a vulture or bat, which may fly to faraway places and transfer what they see into their master's mind. A Cheshire cat, with a Cheshire grin, was not a familiar of Alice in Wonderland, but nevertheless, it helped her find her way. As in the story, this piece shows how it could turn invisible bit by bit. The Cheshire Cat acted as a guide in Wonderland, possibly due to the wandering nature of cats. This one shows a cat's eye view of what may be seen while roaming around the neighborhood. The girl in the red dress has two white wings and has mysteriously covered her face with flowers. Even though her identity is hidden, the background gives away part of her personality, especially the red dragon flying in the clouds. Another theme of the collection has a darker origin and deals with nightmares and evil spirits. What is more frightful, the evil spirits themselves, or the fact that this particular piece was created by a 12-year-old? Where do evil spirits come from? Are they not just figments of our imagination that has been carried away? If you consider a lot of our entertainment movies and TV shows, much of it is fiction based on science or fantasy. Beings like the Aswang from Filipino folklore have the ability to transform into various evil creatures. They become monsters like vampires or werebeasts that hunt for the flesh of children and expecting mothers. We see this girl carrying her holy Bible. If demons truly existed in our world, what would be the outcome? The scars over her face foretell a dire situation for the survival of humanity. La Llorona, or the Weeping Woman, is a vengeful ghost that drowned her children in a river. She is condemned to eternally search for their souls. In this photo, she has left the riverbank and heads into the city. If you hear her cries, you must run away as quickly as possible. There are evil spirits that are actually human. They are the ones that cause war and death, often for both sides of a conflict. A fanatical leader driven by invalid claims and self-righteous pride is very dangerous for all of modern civilization. Herbs carried by a shadowy figure with a bird-like mask. What do you think of looking at this image? The bubonic plague, or Black Death, of mid-14th century Europe was caused by the bite of an infected flea. These fleas used rats as their hosts, who would spread the disease by stowing away on ships, and then come into contact with humans. Without any cure, most who contracted bubonic plague died within 4 to 7 days. From years 1346 to 1353, an estimated 25 million people, or one-third of Europe's entire population at the time, would succumb to the disease. As a modern comparison, COVID-19 has claimed 6.5 million deaths worldwide during its first 3 years, and that's with the advent of modern medicine and vaccines. Imagine if there was no cure today, as was the case with the Black Death. In the 17th century, a harbinger of the Black Death would emerge from the smoke, known as the Plague Doctor. In many cases, these were second-rate physicians, volunteers, or young doctors who were new to the profession. Their attire consisted of a long, waxed, goat leather cloak, a leather shirt, gloves, and boots. Suet, or hard white animal fat, was spread on the clothes to repel bodily fluids. A flat-topped black hat was worn on the head to let others know the person on the inside was a doctor. A stick or cane was carried for examining patients or poking ones that were unruly. The most distinctive feature is the mask of the plague doctor. Its bird-like beak housed perfume or herbs like lavender, mint, or cloves for the doctor to breathe and avoid the toxic miasma thought to be given off by the plague. The herbs within the mask were sometimes set on fire because it was thought the smoke would displace any bad air and protect the doctor more effectively. Two round glass openings protected the eyes, but made the wearer look like an otherworldly bird creature. At the time, some had noble intentions, but given the aggressive nature of the bubonic plague and lack of any known antidotes, the roles of the plague doctors were reduced to recording casualties, assisting in autopsies, and witnessing wills for the dead. It's unfortunate some took advantage of dying victims by providing false cures and treatments in exchange for profit. Similar to the PPE worn by doctors and nurses during the worst of COVID-19, the plague doctor's outfit must have been an imposing sight from the victim's perspective. At least those suffering could take some comfort knowing there was a human soul inside. We have so much access to information and other technology that demands our attention. The Magic and Myth exhibition presents another theme regarding the simpler aspects in life. With nature growing around the trellis above this young girl, did you notice she still carries her cell phone? When humans had to hunt for food, they used cave drawings like these to record what had happened. It was an ancient way of posting on social media or uploading a video online. A better perspective of our planet can be gained by breaking away from our monitors, phones, and tablets to admire the natural world before us. This simple tree shows growth in life, and possibly a message of what may be appreciated by giving flight to our imaginations. Books have long proven a healthy way to give our minds a workout by expanding our vocabulary and letting our spirits soar. When was the last time you sat down with a printed book and read a story? A book can describe a scene. It then falls upon us and our creativity to open a doorway and walk in. When thought of in this manner, a book is an interactive form of entertainment, more so than watching a video, such as this one, for instance. Somehow, the simple act of reading a book unlocks the magic that may be found within its pages. It also gives a chance for our thoughts and dreams to travel to places far beyond the reach of the world we live in. This piece shows the young artist's cultural collision surrounding the U.S.-Mexico border. The Magic and Myth exhibit parallels this idea with a theme that focuses on a combination of universes. Artists create other dimensions that raise questions. Is there a connection between our world and theirs? How do people and things appear in their world? Are sights and sounds different or the same? They say many of us have a doppelganger or look-alike somewhere on our planet. If you're a twin, it's a given. But if it's another you from a parallel universe, does that person have the same thoughts and feelings you have? Objects with a frame usually serve as portals between separate universes. This one has a young man with a magic mirror. It shows he doesn't exist in the other world. Some of us may feel we don't exist in this one. If you feel that way, don't be discouraged. All it takes is the flip of a switch to seize the day and open our eyes, to let a better place materialize. Worlds can be combined with a monster in the water. This brother sits without his sister because the kraken just got her. Blossoms rise over settlements where dimensions have distorted. Drenched in the film negative colors of turquoise and wine. A barn not on land, but on water, unsupported. A bottle holding Kansas within its glass confines. Enchanted creatures or beings embody the magic and myth in our stories and fables. Within this collection at the Museum of Photographic Arts, these figures create mystery and pique our curiosity. An intentionally blurred image leaves more room for details to be filled by our imaginations. Have you ever noticed in movies how supernatural beings avoid the camera until the end? Creatures that inhabit our planet can become part of mythology when cloaked in a sea or sky of darkness. It may explain why griffins, sea monsters, or other magical legends came into existence. Our perception of rock formations can solidify an illusion into reality. This massive cave opening magically morphs into the gaping maw of a leviathan. Some fairy tales tell us the dangers of greed and the virtuous nature of bravery. This reluctant billy goat Gruff knows he must cross the bridge to battle the hungry troll hiding beneath. At times we feel lost in the dead of night, searching for a higher power to help us find our way. A belief in a force greater than ourselves channels our inner strength to cope with any hardship that may arise. Why is it that supernatural creatures or mysterious energies hold such fascination over us? Perhaps it's an aspect of being human, in order to give us hope for the future and bind us to the days of our ancestors. A small section of the Museum of Photographic Arts presents the close-up macro photography of Carl Blossfeldt. In 1881, he began his studies in sculpture and iron casting, and by 1890, Blossfeldt received a scholarship to study in Rome under Moritz Murer, a decorative artist and professor of ornament and design. During this time, he traveled throughout Europe and North Africa, collecting botanical specimens and capturing photographic casts of them. He never received formal instruction in photography and modified cameras to increase their magnification by 30 times to capture clear and precise details of his plant subjects. His intention was to document and use these photos as visual references in classes he taught at the School of the Museum of Decorative Arts in Berlin. Near the end of his life, Blossfeldt published Formen der Kunst, or Art Forms in Nature, which featured 120 captivating macro photographs of plants. The imagery Blossfeldt achieved gained the admiration of his contemporaries and made him one of the most celebrated artists of his time. In the main lobby of the Museum of Photographic Arts are several large-scale prints created by photographer Nick Brandt. The series is titled This Empty World and shows how the natural land and habitat of animals is vanishing rapidly. The main cause is the expansion of human civilization. However, Nick Brandt never portrays humans as enemies of the animals. Instead, they are the unfortunate victims of development and industrialization, just as the animals are powerless to fight for their freedom. Each piece is done on a grand scale, some prints measuring up to 12 feet in length. This one shows an elephant family next to a human family. Most of us may be watching this on a cell phone with a tiny screen. Brandt intended for his photographs to be seen in person. He chose an enormous print size for us to see the forlorn expressions on the human family's faces and the body language of the elephant family with a matching demeanor. In our world of computers with magical photo editing software, these types of situations can be fabricated on the spot. Brandt used a much more elaborate method to achieve what he wanted his camera lens to see through practical effects. Practical effects in movies are objects like props, sets, creatures, or physical stunts that are recorded by a camera rather than being generated by a computer. He created these scenes as a combination of two moments. First, he set up a network of 10 cameras throughout the Maasai community in Kenya. He had watering holes dug in front of camera boxes to attract animals. These remained fixed in place for a period of 6 weeks up to 5 months. They worked, but sometimes attracted uninvited guests, as Brandt calls them. Second, Brandt endured the dust storms along with his equipment and members of the Maasai community. He had scaffolding and stages built around the positions of the fixed cameras. Some would light the area to photograph the people of the Maasai community. Others were used to create the invasion of civilization into the natural world. Brandt took his second picture with a camera in the exact same location as the camera box. When combined, the two separate moments in time create a realization of the responsibility we humans have for the plight of animals. This series illustrates Nick Brandt's first utilization of digital photography and subtleness of color instead of just black and white. He says viewing a photo on a computer monitor, TV screen, or cell phone is deceptive. The inherent backlight can make things appear more attractive than they really are. Brandt prefers to have his work printed and physically in front of him before making a decision whether or not the end result meets his initial expectations. With subdued lighting in an art gallery, the photographs are liberated to show off their vibrant colors with deep blues, brilliant reds, and naturally captured expressions and postures of the animals central to each piece. The structures of mankind, like this gas station, are lit in a harsh white light to show the collision of worlds, with some bleeding over the natural light of this elephant's habitat. All the while, today's children will inherit the earth of tomorrow. At what cost? If changes are not made now to improve the course of our planet's future. Staring into a bright light is not advisable unless we want temporary blindness. Brandt performs some photographic trickery to make us feel the heat and illumination from these floodlights. To get the correct lighting, Brandt used flash units to photograph the animals at night. He then replaced each flash with a continuous light source in the same position to capture surrounding people, buses, or structures. Taking two photos from the same spot with potentially up to 5 months in between requires quite an amount of patience. The resulting print, however, yields a hauntingly real portrayal of animals trapped within the confines of an ever-shrinking circle of nature. Here, Brandt symbolizes the animal's situation with a zebra caught in the headlights. Nick Brandt doesn't compromise his photography by trying to predict what others may desire to see. As an artist, he concentrates on what excites and inspires him in the moment, and lets others develop their own opinions. If you yourself are an artist, consider what motivates you and always follow your heart with art. Whether it's painting, sculpture, literature, or music, once you've found your way through the forest, stay true to the creative passion that resides within you. It's far better to create art modeled after your own vision. If it pleases you when it's done, there's bound to be others that will appreciate your efforts to inspire them as well. If you enjoyed this video, you can help this channel grow. Please like, share, and subscribe. Thanks for watching San Diego Review.